So thank you for joining us. Early last semester, it occurred to me that it had been over 20 years since the publication of the Norton Anthology in African American Literature, and it just felt like a reason to celebrate. And so I thought I'd pull together some very exciting people and invite you all to come, and that's the genesis of this evening. What a better way to recognize the publication of that important volume, and now two volumes, than to convene some of the leading figures in the study of African American literature, not to mention a myriad of other areas, who might lend some insight into the creation, reception, the impact of the volume in the now 22 years since its publication. Publication of the Norton Anthology of African American Literature in 1996 was an intervention, a combination of years of work, the beginning of new conversations and debates. When Danita Smith reviewed it for the New York Times, just less than a week after its publication, she quoted the volume's co-editor, the late Nellie McKay, who said, quote, "No one will be able to say again that they don't know what to teach." So that gives you a sense of just how high the stakes were in ways that we, I think, take for granted today. The volume came out in the midst of what was known as the Canon Wars. What authors should be taught? What was the place of the Western Civ core curriculum? What would it mean to transform the canon with the addition of a more racially and ethnically diverse group of writers, with women? Others argued for an explosion of the very concept of canon itself, and still others explored the ideological underpinnings of its construction. These were heady days, and the debates were all-consuming. Dr. Gates himself penned a New York Times essay published in February 26, 1989, "Whose Canon Is It Anyway?" And later, the collection of essays, "Loose Canons, Notes on the Culture Wars." The Norton Anthology of Literature appeared in this context. General editors Henry Louis Gates and the late beloved Nellie McKay, and period editors William Andrews, Houston Baker, Barbara Christian, Francis Foster, Deborah McDowell, Robert O'Mealy, Aram Rompersad, and Richard Yarborough were intellectual leaders who, through their individual work as critics, scholars, editors, and institution builders, and through the collaborative project of the Norton Anthology, not only further developed the field of African American literature for many of us, those who followed immediately in their footsteps, they helped to, I always think, make our very jobs and careers possible. Later editions were edited by scholars no less significant than the original group, among them Kimberly Benston, Cheryl Wall, and two of tonight's panelists, Brent Edwards and Valerie Smith. If I read the full bios of each of these scholars, we'd be here for 2 hours, so I'm just going to briefly tell you who they are. Elizabeth Alexander is a renowned poet, essayist, playwright, scholar, and social justice arts advocate who is the chancellor, a chancellor of the Academy of American Poets and the Mellon Professor in the Humanities here at Columbia University, Director of Creativity and Free Expression Ford Foundation, and incoming president of the Andrew Mellon Foundation.
Here, here.
She previously taught at Yale University, where we stole her from for 2 years. She chaired the African American Studies Department there. In 2009, she composed and delivered praise song for the day for the inauguration of the president, of President Barack Obama. Her collection of poetry, collections of poetry include Crave Radiance, New and Selected Poems, American Sublime, which was a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize, Antebellum Dream Book, and a number of other important books, including her collection of essays, The Black Interior. Her latest book, the memoir, The Light of the World, was released to great acclaim and was also a finalist for the Pulitzer Prize. Harry Louis Gates, Jr. is the Alphonse Fletcher University Professor and Director of the Hutchins Center for African and African American Research at Harvard University. He is also Emmy Award-winning filmmaker, literary scholar, journalist, cultural critic, and institution builder. Professor Gates has authored or co-authored 21 books, created 15 documentary films, including Black in Latin America and Finding Your Roots, which is his groundbreaking genealogy series now in its third season in PBS. On PBS, Professor Gates has directed the W.B. Du Bois Institute for African American Research, now the Hutchins Center, since arriving at Harvard in 1991, and during his first 15 years on campus, he chaired the Department of Afro-American Studies. He is a member of the American Academy of Arts and Letters, serves on a wide array of boards, including the New York Public Library, Jazz at Lincoln Center, and the Whitney Museum of American Art. I'm trying to do it in order, them in order, but this is not happening that way. Okay, Valerie Smith is a distinguished scholar of African American literature and the 15th president of Swarthmore College. Upon her arrival at Swarthmore, she identified several priorities, among them attracting more low-income and first-generation students and providing for them an exceptional undergraduate experience. Prior to coming to Swarthmore, she taught at UCLA and at Princeton University, where she also served as dean of the college, as well as professor of literature and English and African American studies. She is the recipient of fellowships from the Fletcher Foundation and the Guggenheim Foundation. Her most recent book is a book, Toni Morrison, Writing the Moral Imagination, and she's also the author of several other books and several articles and essays as well. Brent Hayes Edwards is professor of English and comparative literature here at Columbia University. His most recent book is Epistrophes, Jazz, and the Literary Imagination, published just last year, and the groundbreaking The Practice of Diaspora, Literature Translation and the Rise of Black Internationalism, which was published in 2003 and was awarded the John Hope Franklin Prize of the American Studies Association. He is also an editor, a translator of Derrida and Lisan, among many other things, and he is head of the Scholars in Residence Program at the Schomburg Institute, just up the block. Robert O'Mealy is the Zora Neale Hurston Professor of English and Comparative Literature and founder and director of the Center for Jazz Studies. His major interests are American literature, music, and painting. He has written exclusively on Ralph Ellison, including The Craft of Ralph Ellison, a collection of papers for which he served as editor, New Essays on Invisible Man. He has written a beautiful biography on Billie Holiday entitled Lady Day, The Many Faces of Billie Holiday, and he is currently at work on we're eagerly awaiting a volume that he's working on Romere. So without any further ado, I'll turn it over to our panelists, and we will they'll open up with a reading or a selection from the Norton Anthology, and then give us some insight into their involvement in the project and its ongoing significance. And following their sort of conversation with each other, we'll open it up to questions for you. Thank you.
Thank you, Farah, for that. You brought back so many memories. I'm just so touched that you would think of this to commemorate the 22nd anniversary of the anthology. We're supposed to read a selection from the anthology and then make some comments. I'm going to do it, if you don't mind, in the other order, because I just want to tell you how this anthology came about. And it's not something that I think about. You know, Satchel Paige was a very witty person, and one of his favorite expressions was, don't look back, something might be gaining on you. So I just keep moving forward. But thinking about this flying down this afternoon, and over the apartment, I was just trying to go back to the 90s of where this idea came from, and to share some of my experiences in putting this anthology together. And then I'm going to read for the most canonical of novels of all, of course, the best-selling, Their Eyes Are Watching God, which is not in the Norton Anthology. And to give you an example of why some things are anthologized and some things are not, even when they're canonized. I'm an institution builder, as Farah kindly said. That's how I think of myself. And one of the reasons is that I hit campus, I hit Yale in September 1969. And that's when the bulk of Afro-American studies programs, as we called it then, hit campus as well. The only exception, I think, is San Francisco State, which came in 1968. And one of the things that I would not have majored in Afro-American studies. My father would kick me out of the house if I ever did. I had to major in one of the disciplines, and I was raised to be a doctor. I was pre-med. My mother, God rest her soul, thinks that, you know, in heaven, there's the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, and the medical doctor. And that's just what I'm supposed to be. And the last thing my father said to me, my parents bought me a brand new car to send me off to Yale, and a Royal Electric typewriter, right? Because they wanted me to be amongst them, as my mother would say, so that no one could sort of put me down because I was from West Virginia or from the country or for class reasons. And my father said, he called me boy to his dying day. He lived to be 97 and a half. He said, boy, I'm going to do this. He said, don't go up there sitting at something called a black table. And that's in 1969 when all this was coming about. He said, because, you know, you're going to Yale, you're not going to Howard, so I want you to go up there and get to know some white people. He said, don't get black roommates. He said, what's that about? He said, get a white roommate. Try to find a Jewish guy. He said, Jewish people are very good to our people, and it would be a very good thing if you do. And finally, the last thing he said fair was, and for Christ's sake, don't major in no goddamn black studies because your ass has been black for 18 years and I ain't paying for that. Now, I tell the black students in Harvard that anecdote, and they crack up because their parents have told them some variation of that before they hit campus. But I did take a black studies course every semester. I was intrigued by the black experience. I've long been, you know, what metaphorically we call a race man. I could take the front page of the New York Times, and the word Negro or African or African American was on it. I could see it at a glance. Facts about the black experience just clung to me. And that's one way to know, I always tell my students, what you're meant to do. I didn't have to work at remembering. And so I took a black studies course virtually every semester when I was at Yale. And one of the things that I could see even then was that my professors were trying to reinvent the wheel, that we did not have the tools of the discipline necessary to institutionalize the discipline, that these had to be created. And this is 1969. This was the first class, large class of black kids to hit the Ivy League. And we were the affirmative action generation. My class, Sheila Jackson Lee, who's a congresswoman, has Barbara Jordan's seat from Houston. Kurt Schmoke, who's a Rhodes Scholar, 2 years before I graduated, inspired me really to think about going to Oxford. There was a little nerdy pre-med guy in our class. He didn't really hang, as we put it. You know, we used to have what we called Spook Weekend, when the black kids from the Ivy League would come to where one of the schools. We persuaded the administrations to have soul food, and but this guy never hung out. And I was secretary of the Black Student Association, and we had a list of all the black kids. And I had to put an S by anybody who didn't show up at the meetings. An S stood for shaky. And he was one of the kids who was shaky, but he was busy learning how to be a doctor. And his name was a little, I always forget his name, Ben Carson. He was the one. Now I'm just busting Ben. He's a good friend of mine. I don't believe in judging my friend's ideological choices, even if I don't understand them. But as a friend of mine said, that was before Ben was breathing all that ether in, and it, you know, affected his brain. So I was going to go off to England when I graduated and get a second degree. It's called an affiliated degree. You get like Rhodes Scholars. You enroll in a bachelor's degree program. And you get your second BA, and then 5 years you get a master's degree. I was going to come back and go to med school or law school. And there I met two Africans who changed my life. A fellow student, Kwame Anthony and Apia, we all say Apia, and Wole Soyinka. And I ended up falling in love with the study of literature, which has always been a hobby for me because I was a science jock. My verbal, my quantitative scores are 50 points higher in the SATs than my qualitative. I just love the sciences, and that's how I was raised. So when I came back to go to Yale Law School in 1975, and I enrolled in Yale Law School for 30 days. I was enrolled in Yale Law School from September 1st, 1975 to October 1st, 1975, but clearly I knew that was a mistake. And I took a leave of absence. The last time I checked, I was still on leave from the Yale School of Law. Charles Davis, the first black man to get tenure in the English department, hired me because I'm a really good typist. In my high school in West Virginia, we had to take 2 years of typing, all the boys. And he said, I'm going to write your dissertation. I'm going to change your life. You're not going to be a doctor. You're not going to be a lawyer. You're going to be a scholar. And that's what Shoya Ganabia sort of ignited when I was at campus. And so that's how I got my first job. And I realized that this field, which had been introduced to the Academy in 1969, still lacked these basic tools. And because my personality is entrepreneurial, it's something that I have an instinct for. It's very difficult to put into words because it's such a basic part of my personality. But building a team or figuring out how to edit reference tools that you need to institutionalize a field, this is just part and parcel of my makeup. And it took many, many forms. But the most important for me was to put together a Norton Anthology of African American literature. Why? Because as Nellie said in that Times piece of Fair Quoting, many professors would say that they couldn't afford to teach African American literature because the students couldn't buy 10 texts or a novel for each week or whatever, or different anthologies. How could we somehow persuade the W.W. Norton Company to make the economic bet on a Norton Anthology? I took that as a personal challenge. This would be, I thought, the hallmark of my tool-building career, if I could pull this off. So, why? Because the Norton Anthology, particularly then, was the Rolls-Royce of anthologies. If you could get a Norton Anthology, as Ferris said, this was a canon wars. And there were people thinking that A, we did not belong in the Academy, and B, by we, people of African descent, and that our field didn't belong in the Academy, that this was a bogus field that had been forced upon the Academy by students with afros and dashikis who threatened to burn the library down. And as soon as they could get rid of it, they were going to get rid of it, or as soon as they could co-opt it. So how do you fight against that? You can't take over the library all the time. You have to fight in other ways. And the canon wars were raging. So, and I had a lot of friends, because I was part of the deconstruction, post-structural generation at Yale, who used to say to me, why are you trying to canonize African-American literature? We're trying to blow up the canon. But you see, you can't deconstruct the canon until it's constructed. And I had I said that to Jacques Derrida, I said that to Barbara Johnson, I said that to many of my friends. We have to get in the Academy, we have to get in the anthologies, and the subsequent generations come along, call us Uncle Tom's, Aunt Jane's, blow it up. But we've got to get in it, that we are behind in terms of the institutional history for our field. And the last time I checked, the greatest canon maker, the canon making company, was W.W. Norton. And that's the gates we had to storm. It took me 2 years to persuade W.W. Norton to do this anthology. Now they brag about it for commercial reasons and political reasons, but 2 years, they undertook a marketing survey. They had to persuade themselves, Elizabeth, that they could sell 1,000 copies of this anthology over a 2 year period. And if they couldn't prove that, then the numbers were not going to justify doing this anthology. Could we sell that many copies? Oh my God. So I went to Cornell as a professor, and I didn't get tenure at Yale, but I was made a full professor when I was 33 at Cornell, and Yale didn't respond to that with tenure. They promoted me to associate professor without tenure and told me to write another book. So of course I left and I went to Cornell. It was very sad for me because I was East Yale, right? And I had this whole fantasy of a career all laid out. I was going to live in New Haven the rest of my life. I had two daughters. They were born in New Haven. I came of age in New Haven. That was the way it was going to be, but it didn't work out that way. God works in mysterious ways. Who was my neighbor? M.H. Abrams. Who's M.H. Abrams? The guy who invented the Norton Anthology. He was in the English department. I mean, before I went up there, I thought he was dead, you know, because he was a whole guy. And he loved Anthony Appiah and me. And there was a secret society of Cornell professors called the Vicious Circle. And he got us, and we were the first black people to be made members of this secret society. Well, it's a secret, so I guess I'm not supposed to say it. But and with Max Black, the great philosopher. So we used to have these meetings. And I would say, Mike, you are standing in the way. You are the only obstacle toward our accomplishing our goal of institutionalizing African-American literature through the Norton Anthology. Because he had the final vote. He became a millionaire being the general editor of all the Norton Anthologies. You know, every Norton Anthologist guy got a cut of because he was the editor of the Norton Anthology of English Literature, and a brilliant man. And finally, he was persuaded, which was the only reason that in the end that Norton decided to do it. So after 2 years, I had the green light. So what did I have to do? I needed a co-general editor. Nellie McKay was not my first choice as co-general editor, and Farrah did not know this until she picked me up at the gate. The first co-general editor of the Norton was Mary Helen Washington. And Mary Helen and I were friends, and you know, it was very political choosing the editorial structure of the Norton. And Mary Helen was a leading feminist critic, and I thought that that was appropriate. She published more than Nellie had. You know, we all debated it, and so I asked Mary Helen. After about a year, Mary Helen decided that she resigned. She said, we're never going to be able to pull this off. It's an impossible thing to do. And so I went to Nellie, and I called Nellie, and she goes, huh, Mary Helen quit, huh? And you didn't ask me a year ago, did you? And so I had to beg Nellie, and for about 5 minutes, and she accepted, and that was a really great choice. I had to select people in my generation. I'm 67 years old. It's very important that the first generation of editors be generational. They had to be what are now the among the elders of our tradition. Period. Nortons are all based on historical principles. You know, it's like a chronological approach to literature. We could not be reinventing the format of a Norton. We couldn't be talking about themes. It had to be the 18th century, 19th century, the 20th century. So, but I wanted to do a twist on that. So I told them that I was only going to do it if I could add a vernacular editor. Because so much of the African American literary tradition is spoken or oral. And so we had a big debate about that. And I told him I wanted to put a little sleeve in it with a disc. You know, I think we started out with it. Well, we were thinking about doing a cassette tape. This is like backward technology, right? Then a CD-ROM and a DVD. And it took us so long to do it, the technology changed from what we had agreed to do. And there was only one person to be the vernacular editor, and that was Bob O'Mealy, who was very good and old friend. And Bob had 15,000 albums and knew 1,000 verses of the Signifying Monkey and China and Titanic. So, I mean, he was the. we could not have debates about the canon. The most important thing that we did was to prevent the editors from arguing about what was going to be in the anthology. And Bob will tell you this is something that I insisted on. And how do we get around that? By giving every editor or editors of each period total control over the content. The final votes, of course, were cast by Nellie and by me, so in the case of an argument. But 99% of what went in each period was decided by the period editors. But everybody, when we started, wanted to have a big theoretical debate about what the canon should be, where you can start with Phyllis Wheatley, or you start with Brenton Hammond, or do you start with Barr's Fight by Lucy Terry, how much Ellis? No. Because we never, ever would have finished that anthology. If one person, if Bob O'Mealy had been able to tell Houston Baker what to put in the Black Arts period, or Houston Baker had been allowed to tell Bob O'Mealy what to do in the vernacular section, we never would have finished, because they never would have agreed. So every time people try to talk, have a theoretical discussion about the canon, I just said, no, the discussion's over. And the only way to do that was to give every editor maximum authority. The biggest problem that I had was not to get people to agree to be editors, but to get them to believe that we could do it. You can't imagine how tall that mountain was of editing a Norton the first time around. Farrah said to me that she remembers what an event it was when it was published. The Times wrote about it. The Times is not reviewing Norton anthologies. It was a big deal to get them to do a 2,500-page anthology and make the financial commitment to it. It costs hundreds of thousands of dollars in permissions to do this. It's a bet on an emerging field. But I realized after people had agreed to be editors that what was going to keep us from succeeding was self-doubt among the 10 other editors. That somehow we weren't going to be able to pull this off. So I summoned everybody to come to Cornell and the provost speak. The president said, agreed. We had official photographers. We had a chef come. I mean, all this stuff sounds like smoke and mirrors, and in a way, it is smoke and mirrors. Because I had to persuade everybody that the project was real, that the project was doable. And once we took the official photograph, what are they going to do? Not edit. You know, this was a historic moment. Du Bois realized that. Look at all of the photographs of the Encyclopedia of the Negro and Encyclopedia Africana. You know, you freeze the moment, you institutionalize the moment, you begin to hypnotize people to believe that that they could do it. And you know what else? When they came to Cornell for the organizational weekend, I had a bound volumes of the table contents of every anthology that had been published of African American literature. So that everyone could begin to see that you don't have to start with a blank slate. You can think about what did Langston Hughes put in the Book of American Negro Folklore? You know, what was in James Weldon Johnson's Book of American Negro Poetry in 1922? Just think of all those anthologies that had been published. So we arranged them chronologically, and then we were able to subdivide their period listings, so that you could begin to think about what the canon implicitly already was. People weren't theorizing about the canon, but every act of anthology making or anthology editing is an act of canon making. So that it was a way of grounding expectations and making it less frightful. But despite that, it took 10 years. Between the time we had our organizational meeting in Ithaca, New York, and the time that New York Times Review appeared. 10 years. I was a professor at Cornell, I was a professor at Duke, and then I was a professor at Harvard. In the end, what we did a kind of trick, which was prepare sample head notes and footnotes that people could riff on and edit and reject, and that helped to break the logjam. And finally, in 1996, it was published in a hardback trade edition with the DVD. It's the best-selling hardback anthology in the history of W.W. Norton. And the first anthology anywhere that was published with the oral tradition recorded on a DVD. And that's the Norton Anthology, and it's 22 years later. And it makes me so happy that we did it and that you all came to celebrate that. So thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Farrah, for putting this together. All right, the problem is we couldn't buy the rights to Their Eyes Are Watching God. And Jay writes poetry. Jay Wright is not in here because, I mean, I saw him, I had him to dinner. I begged him to let us publish his poetry, and he said no, because it would cut down on his sales, which is exactly the reverse of what it would have done. But the Hurston estate said, no way, because this thing is a proverbial cash cow, and they did not want it in the Norton Anthology. So I'm going to read you the section of... This is when Janie has her moment of insight, and it is necessary for her to understand that she can navigate between consciousnesses, as the text says, that she has an inside and an outside now, before she's able to articulate her identity and free herself. And it's an extension, just to show you how literary traditions work metaphorically, it's an extension, it's another riff upon W.E.B. Du Bois's metaphor of double consciousness, which of course Get Out is as well. And I just gave a lecture about that to Mark, maybe intro to Afro.
Of course, but the sunken place is the moment of double consciousness, right? So Janie, where he left her, Janie stood where he left her for, I'm sorry. You sure loves to tell me what to do, but I can't tell you nothing that I see. That's because you need telling, he rejoined highly. It would be pitiful if I didn't. Somebody got to think for women and children and chickens and cows. I got, they sure don't think none for themselves. I know a few things, and women folks think sometimes too. Oh, no, they don't. They just think things. When I see one thing, I understand 10. You see 10 things and don't understand one. The irony of that line is that it's Joe who is the literalist, and it's Janie who is the metaphorist, as it were. It's exactly the opposite of what he says. Times and scenes like that put Janie to thinking about the inside state of her marriage. Time came when she fought back with her tongue as best she could, but it didn't do her any good. It just made Joe do more. He wanted her submission, and he'd keep on fighting until he felt he had it. So gradually, she pressed her teeth together and learned to hush. The spirit of the marriage left the bedroom and took to living in the parlor. It was there to shake hands whenever company came to visit, but it never went back inside the bedroom again. So she put something in there to represent the spirit, like a Virgin Mary image in a church. The bed was no longer a daisy field for her and Joe to play in. It was a place where she went and lay down when she was sleepy and tired. She wasn't petal open with him anymore. She was 24 and 7 years married when she knew. She found that out one day when he slapped her face in the kitchen. It happened over one of those dinners that chase in all women sometimes. They plan and they fix and they do, and then some kitchen-dwelling fiend slips scratchy, soggy, tasteless mess into their pots and pans. Janie was a good cook, and Joe had looked forward to his dinner as a refuge from other things. So when the bread didn't rise, and the fish wasn't quite done at the bone, and the rice was scorched, he slapped Janie until she had a ringing sound in her ears and told her about her brains before he stalked on back to the store. Janie stood where he left her for unmeasured time and thought. She stood there until something fell off the shelf inside her. Then she went inside there to see what it was. It was her image of Jody, tumbled down and shattered, but looking at it, she saw that it never was the flesh and blood figure of her dreams. In a way, she turned her back upon the image where it lay and looked further. She had no more blossomy openings, dusting pollen over her man, neither any glistening young fruit where the petals used to be. She found that she had a host of thoughts she had never expressed to him, and numerous emotions she had never let Jody know about. Things packed up and put away in parts of her heart where he could never find them. She was saving up feelings for some man she had never seen. She had an inside and an outside now, and suddenly she knew how not to mix them. She bathed, baptismal scene, the new identity, right? And put on a fresh dress and handkerchief, and went on to the store before Jody had time to send for her. That was a bow to the outside of things. And after she has that moment of self-awareness, of course, she goes on to confront Jody in the store, playing the dozens on his manhood. and unmanning him, quote unquote, by talking about his impotency. And he dies in typical Hurston fashion of a displaced kidney failure. And she goes on to fall in love with tea cake and learn how to play and to learn to express her sexuality. This is the one that got away from the Norton Anthology. Anyway, thank you. Thank you very much.
So I'd like to begin by thanking Skip for conceiving the idea of a Norton Anthology of African American Literature and for hosting that 1986 gathering of scholars that included Bob O'Mealy, who would go on to become period editors of the anthology. I'm grateful to all of the editors who have worked collaboratively since then to bring this project to fruition and to renew its vision at periodic intervals. And I also want to thank Farah for bringing this group together to celebrate the 22nd anniversary of the publication of the anthology. I'm honored to share the stage with my friends and colleagues and to have the opportunity to reflect upon the importance of this volume with all of you. Now, apart from occasional guest lectures or seminars, I actually haven't taught since I became president of Swarthmore in 2015. So I was especially happy to be able to revisit my copies of all three editions of the Norton in preparation for this event. As I studied these volumes to figure out what I wanted to say, three things caught my attention. First, as Skip and our late dear Nellie McKay observe in the introduction to the second edition of the Norton, it was no small irony that those who committed to editing this volume were themselves scholars of a literary tradition that for the most part had been excluded from the canons of American and Western literature. Some of them had criticized the idea of canon formation elsewhere. However assiduously the custodians or caretakers of certain traditions might wish to affirm the timelessness of the standards by which certain texts are included or excluded, critics of African-American and other historically marginalized traditions knew that those standards inevitably rest upon subjective assumptions about intellectual capacity and aesthetic quality. Yet even as they might have been somewhat skeptical of the project of canonizing a literary tradition, the editors nevertheless agreed, as Skip and Nellie put it, that they needed to construct a canon before they could deconstruct it. They recognized that high school teachers, college and university professors, and general readers needed to be able to find in one place, quote, the selections that allow the in-depth study of the major writers in the tradition. In its sheer scope and inclusiveness, they go on to say, the Norton enables readers to trace the repetitions, tropes, and signifying that define the tradition. Now, the evolution of the Norton across three editions demonstrates that the process of canon formation need not be staid or stultifying. Rather, the Norton Anthology of African American Literature demonstrates that canon formation is a dynamic process. Even as it seeks to codify the texts one should know to understand the tradition, the changes to the table of contents reveal the variety of factors that go into the act of establishing an archive, newly discovered works from earlier periods, the ascendancy of new generations of writers and artists, changes in theoretical paradigms and approaches, the evolution of interpretive frameworks, the emergence of newly articulated literary and cultural historical paradigms, and the development of new technologies. Furthermore, this Norton has always understood that African-American literature does not exist only on the page. So from the audio CD that Skip mentioned a few moments ago, from the audio CD that accompanied the first edition to the instructor resource disc that accompanies the third, the Norton pays tribute to the vocal, instrumental, spoken word, and visual dimensions and resonances of African-American literature. I also noticed as I was preparing my remarks for this event, that the physical volumes of the Norton in my personal library tell a story. As I looked at where I had stuck post-it flags, you know, that sort of hang off the edge, it's like there's an additional dimension, right? Because I pick it up and I feel all these post-its, and it's a really sort of tactile sort of memory, side of memory for me. So as I looked at the post-it flags, I sort of thumbed through the pages, I saw the marginal notes and other traces of class preparation and discussion, sort of a little bit of coffee stained here and this kind of thing, right? I marveled at how well used these volumes were. I thought about the thumbing through the pages, I was transported back into the rooms where my students and I have considered the power of Ann Spencer's letter to my sister, or wrestled with the intricacies of Jean Toomer's Cane, or reflected upon the use of urban space in Edward P. Jones's The Girl Who Raised Pigeons. These memories prompted me to reflect on another subject as well, and that is the intergenerational legacy of this anthology. Many of us were drawn to this field because of our deep love for the literature, the music, and the visual art. We appreciated their capacity to uplift the spirit, to emancipate the mind, to galvanize political conscience and awareness. 30 years ago or more, we crafted syllabi out of available editions. And when our preferred texts weren't available, we taught from Xeroxes of Xeroxed pages from out of print editions because of the Norton and other reprints, and out of print editions. But because of the Norton and other reprint series, we can provide a richer, more complex account of African American literary history. Many of our students will tell us that their love for Black literature took root in our classrooms because of their exposure to these texts. In some instances, they have gone on to teach these volumes and cultivate their own students' passion for Black literature and culture. Now, I took some time to decide which selection from the Norton I would read this evening. Initially, I intended to read a selection from the third edition that did not appear in the earlier editions. And I should say, as an aside, that I had the honor of being asked to be Skip's co-general editor on the third edition after Nellie McKay passed away. So that's my relationship to this project. But in the end, I returned, so I thought I would perhaps select a piece of writing from the third edition that had not been in the earlier two. But in the end, I returned to the passage from Sonny's Blues that so often compels me, and I'm going to read from that and then say a little about that in a minute. What I love about this passage that I'm about to read is the variety of ways in which it meditates on time. And I think that I was sort of drawn to it because as I reflected on the power and the impact of the Norton anthology, I kept thinking about the ways in which it made me think about time, the forward movement of time, and the power of retrospection. So let me read from this excerpt now, and then I will. And then I'll go back to commenting on it in a minute, okay? It's a great choice. I'm trying to figure out what happened to the page. And here we go. Sorry, here we go. It's right here. Okay, here we go. All right. Daddy was big and rough and loud talking, just the opposite of Sonny. But they both had that same privacy. Mama tried to tell me something about this just after Daddy died. I was home on leave from the Army. This was the last time I ever saw my mother alive. Just the same, this picture gets all mixed up in my mind with pictures I had of her when she was younger. The way I always see her is the way she used to be on a Sunday afternoon, say, when the old folks were talking after the big Sunday dinner. I always see her wearing her pale blue. She'd be sitting on the sofa, and my father would be sitting in the easy chair not far from her, and the living room would be full of church folks and relatives. There they sit in chairs all around the living room, and the night is creeping up outside, but nobody knows it yet. You can see the darkness growing against the window panes, and you hear the street noises every now and again, or maybe the jangling beat of a tambourine from one of the churches close by. But it's real quiet in the room. For a moment, nobody's talking, but every face looks darkening, like the sky outside. And my mother rocks a little from the waist, and my father's eyes are closed. Everyone is looking at something a child can't see. For a moment, they've forgotten the children. Maybe a kid is lying on the rug, half asleep. Maybe somebody's got a kid in his lap and is absentmindedly stroking the kid's head. Maybe there's a kid, quiet and big-eyed, curled up in a big chair in the corner. The silence, the darkness coming, and the darkness in the faces frightens the child obscurely. He hopes that the hand which strokes his forehead will never stop, will never die. He hopes that there will never come a time when the old folks won't be sitting around the living room, talking about where they've come from and what they've seen and what's happened to them and their kinfolk. But something deep and watchful in the child knows that this is bound to end, is already ending. In a moment, someone will get up and turn on the light. Then the old folks will remember the children and they won't talk anymore that day. And when light fills the room, the child is filled with darkness. He knows that every time this happens, he's moved just a little closer to that darkness outside. The darkness outside is what the old folks have been talking about. It's what they've come from. It's what they endure. The child knows that they won't talk anymore because if he knows too much about what's happened to them, he'll know too much too soon about what's going to happen to him. So, as I said, what I love about this passage so much is the variety of ways in which it meditates on time. The narrator distills a lifetime of memories of his mother into this one evocative scene. He captures the feeling of time trembling between states, the way late Sunday afternoons hold back the uncertainty and the onslaught of a new week. I always feel like this is written for people who have to go to school on Monday, but that's another story. I also love the way this recollection in this passage teeters on the brink between a specific moment and a habitual one, sort of like the moment between sort of a past imperfect and a simple past. I'm always struck as well by the way this painterly evocative memory, so visual, has so fully moved into and taken space in my own imagination that it has shaped my own memories of the waning hours of family time. Because texts like Sonny's Blues are now so widely and so easily available, even more readers will be able to find and understand themselves more deeply in African American literature. Thank you.
Skip said, okay, Uncle Remus, go on and do your thing. Good evening to everyone to begin with. I want to start that way because my text for today will be that I want to live the life I sing about in my song. And I want that idea to hang in the air as I go forward. I have to say that this occasion has a feeling of a family reunion for me. I've known these folks most of my life,
And it's very moving for me to see Gates and I were graduate students and emerging just first job professors when we met. And it's really wonderful to, I've known Elizabeth a long time, and everyone here. So it's please know that we are people who love one another. We've been working together. We've been colleagues together in a very, very rich sense for a very, very long time. So it's not just an honor, but it's a great pleasure just to sit here with these folks. I should say too that there are many people in the room that are part of the family reunion, and it's impossible to name them all. I have to say Saidiya Hartman is our beloved colleague in the department here, and there are many other colleagues here at Barnard and other teachers around the city, scholars, writers, and graduate students on their way. It's part of a continuum that has been in part enabled by the Gates Initiative and by this anthology. So I want to acknowledge that fact and acknowledge the creation of the pipeline that you were talking about in that first meeting, and the sense of a continuum that's very rich. I want to play you a song by Mahalia Jackson singing, "I Want to Live the Life I Sing About in My Song." And I play it to make the point that this anthology is one that does have an audio component, and that did its best to make the point that this is a tradition to see, and to see more richly than ever, now that it has pictures of artworks in it. But it's also one to hear as we read the texts aloud and hear the spoken voices in them, as we've done tonight, but also to hear on this, in the set of recordings that are available. I want to use the occasion to thank Skip Gates publicly for including me in this volume. He's right that the idea of the vernacular was his idea to put this in the anthology, and it was a wonderful opportunity for me, and has involved a search that I've been involved in for the rest of my career, the rest of my life. And so it's been a lovely paycheck now and then from the Norton, but it's also just been, it's opened career a direction for me. The question of how to fit the Dirty Dozens and other play it by ear and play it by eye forms of expression into our understandings of Black American life has been the question of this part of the book. What is the relation of the vernacular to the conventionally heralded high arts? I was remembering while you were talking, though, that early on, Gates said, "Yeah, man, you're going to work on the oral tradition." My daddy always said that the oral tradition is not worth the paper it's written on. So you got that one, brother. And so anyway, a lot of good memories that go with it, and trying to put this together has been a wonderful work. I'm also grateful to my colleague, Farrah Griffin, who's a colleague par excellence, if ever there was one, my dear sister, for helping us to think through this event and reminding me of a part played in the creation of the field of African American studies by Stanford University, a place that's usually not included in these histories. But when I was an undergraduate in the late 60s, Robert Steptoe was a graduate student there. William J. Harris was a first-year student. The undergraduates coming after me included Gloria Watkins, known to you as Bell Hooks, Nathaniel Mackey. The faculty included, off and on, Ishmael Reed and Al Young. People on and off the campus included Angela Davis, members of the Black Panther Party, members of the Watts Writers Workshop, routinely on the campus, some of them as students on the campus, and they were part of the excitement. When I was an undergraduate, as a freshman and sophomore, there was a course called The Negro in Our Literature, as I mentioned earlier. And other than that, there was no Black presence in the curriculum. But it was during those years that undergraduates and graduates went to the school and helped initiate a first course. My first teaching experience was as an undergraduate. All the undergraduates who'd come to that meeting insisting that there be a Black literature course were invited to help teach that first course. So that was quite a wonderful breakthrough for me and as learning opportunity with Steptoe and others. By the time I was a senior, Sinclair Drake was teaching a course on Black expression as part of a Pan-African view. So we were beginning to get traction and beginning to get somewhere early on in those days. So say I want to play a piece by Mahalia Jackson, and I want to use it to think about that song as part of a tradition of spirit possession, as a tradition of shouting. It seems to me that you can look at shouting in much the same way that Skip Gates has invited us to think about a signifying, that is, to take a term from the tradition itself and to think about it as a way of understanding theoretically what's going on within the African-American tradition broadly construed. A shout is a possession release. It's a testimony that the Lord has possessed you and that you are full of the Spirit and expressing it with your body and your voice and with your shoes. That some of you know that there are churches where they say, bring your shouting shoes tonight because we're going to get there. We're going to have church. The fact that the shout is also something that we know as a secular thing, you can shout almost anywhere, whether you go to church or not. And when James P. Johnson named his piece, a ragtime piece of the 20s, Carolina Shout, he wasn't thinking about church first. He might have had it in mind somewhat, but he certainly was thinking about Harlem parties as places that would offer a shout in the sense of just showing your own jubilation at life and the good times that parties could bring. So shout has to do with literature, as I'll try to indicate in a minute. It certainly has to do with music. When Ramar Bearden named his piece Carolina Shout, he was thinking about the baptism that's depicted there and about the transformation that the water can bring, the changing your name and shouting in that sense. But there's another piece that has much the same imagery that is called Baptism, which makes you think again about the very fact of baptism and now of Carolina Shout as secular and sacred moments of exaltation, body, soul, cleansing, spiritual, and sacred. As if that weren't enough to try to think about, let's put Ellison and Richard Wright into the picture. Ellison responding to Wright and his particular upbringing reminds us that Mr. Wright did not know how to dance, that he did not know much about the gospel church service as I'm talking about it, or about possessions of the Holy Spirit in this sense. What I'd like to suggest is that with an assist from Ellison and bearing in mind Farrah's writing about Billie Holiday, the moment of the shout, whether dance or song, sacred and as well as secular, is as an important an aspect of African-American vernacular expression as any other. And I don't mean to say this to signify it, my brother here, but the shout is something else that we might think about. Here's what Richard Wright wrote. How Bigger Was Born. He wrote, when the reviews of Uncle Tom's Children began to appear, I realized that I'd made an awful naive mistake. I found that I'd written a book that even bankers' daughters could read and weep over and feel good about. And I swore to myself if I ever wrote another book, no one would ever weep over it, that it would be so hard and deep that they'd have to face it without the consolation of tears. Some decades later, Ellison commented on Wright and said, Wright was bemused by the fact that his work could move his white readers to tears. Now I'm quoting something in the Norton Anthology, remembering Richard Wright. Wright saw this as an evasion of the intended impact of his vision. Thus he began to talk over and over again of forging such hard mechanical images and actions that no white reader could afford the luxury of tears. But here, Ellison wrote, I must turn critic. for in my terms, Wright failed to grasp the function of artistically induced catharsis, which suggests that he failed also to understand the Afro-American custom of shouting in church, a form of ritual catharsis, or its power to cleanse the mind and redeem and rededicate the individual to forms of ideal action. Perhaps he failed to understand or else rejected those moments of exaltation wherein man's vision is quickened by the eloquence of an orchestra, an actor, orator, or dancer, or by anyone using the arts of music or speech or symbolic gesture to create within us moments of high consciousness, moments wherein we grasp in an instant, a knowledge of how transcendent, abysmal, and yet how affirmative it can be to be human. Yet it is for such moments of inspired communication that the artist lives. The irony here is that Wright could evoke such tearful moments, but felt for ideological reasons that tears were a betrayal of the struggle for freedom. I disagreed with his analysis, for tears can induce as well as deter action. And now Ellison refers to shouting so hard that the tears come down. Before I play the Mahalia Jackson piece, finally, I might say that I could read Ellison's piece on Mahalia Jackson, the best one ever written, where he talks about her and the traditions that she comes out of. I could talk more about the song written by Thomas A. Dorsey, whom some of you know was a great blues piano player before he was converted to the church and wrote Precious Lord, Take My Hand, which is in our anthology, as well as this song called I Want to Live the Life I Sing About in My Song. We catch Mahalia Jackson in this recording at the Newport Jazz Festival. She's facing a huge outdoor crowd. And she's used to singing to church people. She's done concerts, but here's a huge outdoor crowd that's come to hear jazz. So they come to swing. She comes out and they're thinking, oh, here comes swinging Mahalia Jackson. And the piano player, Mildred Falls, is ready to accommodate them. And so she's jumping in with the hard swinging version of this that you can hear on her first record, The World's Greatest Gospel Singer. But then Mahalia Jackson does what Robert Ferris Thompson talks about. She changes the rhythm. She comes in and invites what he calls the flash of the spirit or the shout by saying, we're not here to entertain you. We're here to make you shout. We're here to bring the tears down. We're here to hold a real church service. I live the life I sing about in my song. I've come to testify to that. So listen to the way this begins, and then listen to me. She doesn't shout, but at a certain point she says, oh my, as if to say, we're in church. We got church going here now. Okay.
Can you guys hear the mic?
Yeah. Okay. Well, let me just say, before we start.
Why don't you just sing?
Yeah, I'm gonna sing this thing. Listen the way she starts, and watch for this moment when Mahalia Jackson enters and says, "No, we're gonna do it for real." You hear this?
That's quiet.
I'm gonna live the life I sing about in my song. My.
Good evening. I'm also going to read a couple of things, but excerpts, when we read one at the beginning and one at the end. I chose a couple of excerpts that, to me, said something about the inherent multiplicity, the polyvocality, and the formal variance of the anthology as a form. You'll know who the authors are. Their names are in the pieces, and I'll say a little bit in between. At certain times, I have no race. I am me. When I set my hat at a certain angle and saunter down 7th Avenue, Harlem City, feeling as snooty as the lions in front of the 42nd Street Library, for instance, so far as my feelings are concerned, Peggy Hopkins Joyce on the Boul' Miche' with her gorgeous Raymond, stately carriage, knees knocking together in a most aristocratic manner, has nothing on me. The cosmic Zora emerges. I belong to no race nor time. I am the eternal feminine with its string of beads. I have no separate feeling about being an American citizen and colored. I'm merely a fragment of the great soul that surges within the boundaries. My country, right or wrong. Sometimes I feel discriminated against, but it does not make me angry. It merely astonishes me. How can any deny themselves the pleasure of my company? It is beyond me. But in the main, I feel like a brown bag of miscellany propped against a wall in company with other bags, white, red, and yellow. Pour out the contents, and there is discovered a jumble of small things, priceless and worthless. A first water diamond, an empty spool, bits of broken glass, lengths of string, a key to a door long since crumbled away, a rusty knife blade,
old shoes saved for a road that never was and never will be, a nail bent under the weight of things too heavy for any nail, a dried flower or two still a little fragrant. In your hand is the brown bag. On the ground before you is the jumble it held, so much like the jumble in the bags, could they be emptied, that all might be dumped in a single heap and the bags refilled without altering the content of any greatly. A bit of colored glass, more or less, would not matter. Perhaps that's how the great stuffer of bags filled them in the first place. Who knows? So it's a pleasure to be here. I'm the baby of the group. The junior member of the team. In 2012, I replaced, or was asked to replace, Arnold Ramprasad as the period editor of the Harlem Renaissance section. And that said, that still makes me old. I'm still old enough that I remember the first time I heard, I don't think I've ever told you this, but the first time I heard Skip Gates speak, I was an undergraduate, and I remember he gave a presentation on this anthology he was working on. "We're going to have a Norton," he said. He was very proud of the fact that, as you mentioned before, "and it's going to have cassettes." It's not a company I ever imagined joining. It had never crossed my mind. It reminds me a little bit of an anecdote that I think I first heard from the late legal scholar Derrick Bell. William Hastie, who was the first black federal judge in the U.S., was once confronted at a public event at a conference by a righteous young brother after he had given a speech. "Judge," the young blood asked sarcastically, "how does it feel to be part of the system?" Without missing a beat, Hastie replied, "Young man, I'm not part of the system. I am the system." It's very interesting to be asked to be the system. It's hard to imagine, in part because it seems to me that one of the ways we are formed as scholars is in productive tension with the canon. And for me, that productive tension was particularly about the sense of the canon of the Harlem Renaissance and the ways its contours had been understood over multiple generations of scholarship. Some of my work looks at what you might call the constitutive outside of the Harlem Renaissance, the way it's formed by its correspondences with and relations with, but then disavowals of, a range of outer national interlocutors. So to have to revise and stand for, be named under the Harlem Renaissance is an interesting thing to be asked to do. There was immediate consensus about some changes, some things that I thought and that Skip and the other editors, Skip and Val and the other editors on the team, including Arnold, who we consulted as I was coming in, seemed obvious. First priority was to give a complete cane. Gene Toomer's text in the previous edition had been missing Cabinets, the last section of Cain. And one of the special things about the Norton, aside from the multimedia aspect, is that it includes a number of full texts, but Cain wasn't complete. So that was one of the obvious things that everyone agreed on. There were some people that I knew I wanted to put in. Richard Bruce Nugent, who is arguably the most important queer black writer of the Harlem Renaissance. Hubert Harrison, I think, is one of the most important political thinkers, as well as literary critics of the Renaissance period, and the first editor of Marcus Garvey's Negro World. But the challenge in particular was that I was inclined to be too canonical. Skip asked me, well, instructed me, ordered me. I remember the way he phrased it. He said, "Brent, I want you to internationalize the section." And I thought, you do? It's a difficult task when the Norton, as it's described, still in the preface, in the front of the anthology, as an anthology of, quote, I'm quoting from the preface, "African-American literature published principally in English in England and the United States between 1746 and the present." How do you get to the outer national? How do you bring the outer national, how do you bring that constitutive outside into the canon? We did reconsider every aspect of the section, keeping in mind the pragmatic reality that it would not be possible to change, and the pragmatic part of editing, both the permissions costs and the space issues, were the part that surprised me the most, the real difficult calculations that just had to do with how many lines you had. It would not be possible to change but so much even if we wanted to, because the Norton is, after all, a teaching text that thousands of teachers and students have become accustomed to. You can't just change the whole thing. So part of what the difficulty for me was to revise the section in the wake of, and in no small degree, in the voice of Arnold Rampersad. If you've read Arnold Rampersad's work or know him personally, as some of us do, it's a very interesting voice to try to be in. I couldn't just rewrite all the head notes in order to write them the way I might have written them. I had to revise things but be writing with him, even though he was not directly participating. I did try to choose carefully both writers like Nugent and Harrison that expanded the fields in ways I thought were crucial, but in thinking about some of the outer national representation, some Caribbean writers in particular, both Anglophone, Hispanophone, and Francophone, that I put into the canon. So Eric Walrond was another glaring absence, I thought. We've included one short story from Tropic Death. René Maron, the Guyanese, French Guyanese writer who grew up in Martinique and served in the French colonial service in Africa, and Nicolas Guillen, the Cuban writer, a couple of poems from Nicolas Guillen. But I had to be careful about how to bring that in. In other words, with Maron, I felt that I could make a case in the headnote that Maron actually is a direct influence on the Harlem Renaissance. He is part of the Harlem Renaissance. Everybody from Alain Locke to Marcus Garvey says that Batoila, his Prix Goncourt, the French equivalent of the Pulitzer Prize, was a major influence when it's translated in 1922 on all the literature that emerges in the US in English in the rest of that decade. There's more to say, but I'm going to read one other thing. I don't have enough time to read it. Somebody almost walked off with all of my stuff. Not my poems or a dance I gave up in the street, but somebody almost walked off with all of my stuff, like a kleptomaniac, working hard and forgetting while stealing. This is mine. This ain't your stuff. Now why don't you put me back and let me hang out with my own self? Somebody almost walked off with all of my stuff and didn't care enough to send a note home saying I was late for my solo conversation or two sizes too small for my own tacky skirts. What can anybody do with something of no value on an open market? Did you get a dime for my things? Hey man, where are you going with all of my stuff? This is a woman's trip and I need my stuff to be able to ooh and ah about. Daddy, I got a mainline number for my own shit. Now won't you put me back and let me play this duet with this silver ring in my nose? Honest to God, somebody almost ran off with all of my stuff and I didn't bring anything but the kink and sway of it, the perfect ass for my man, and none of it is theirs. This is mine, Entozake, her own things. That's my name. Now give me my stuff. I see you hiding my laugh and how I sit with my legs open sometimes to give my crotch some sunlight. And there goes my love, my toes, my chewed up fingernails. Nigger, with the curls in your hair, Mr. Louisiana Hot Link. I want my stuff back, my rhythms and my voice. Open my mouth and let me talk you out of throwing my shit in the sewer. This is some delicate leg and whimsical kiss I gotta have to give to my choice without you coming off with all of my shit. Hey man, this is not your prerogative. I gotta have me in my pocket to get round like a good woman should and make the poem in the pot or the chicken in the dance. What I got to do, I gotta have my stuff to do it to. Why don't you find your own things and leave this package of me for my destiny? What you got to get from me, I'll give it to you. Yeah, I'll give it to you. Around 5 in the winter when the sky is blue red and Dew City is getting pressed. If it's really my stuff, you gotta give it to me if you really want it. I'm the only one can handle it.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I want to pick up the theme of friendship because it's actually very, very important. It's important not just to say that we love each other, which we do, and to say how special it is and how grateful we are to Farah for bringing us together. I've been looking forward to this ever since it was first proposed. But also to emphasize the mission that is what binds us together, that all of us share in common a fervent and messianic and mission-driven love for Black culture. And without that kind of mission-driven love, there wouldn't be this Norton Anthology, there wouldn't be the organizations and departments and places that we can all share with all of you and beyond the treasures that are at the center of this country's cultural production over the hundreds of years. So that's really, you know, why talking about the friendship is so important. Talking about the friendship is also important because it marks a very particular set of decades in Black culture, in the academy, and in Black cultural studies. So Skip Gates was my professor when I was an undergraduate, and I was a research assistant for him back when being a research assistant meant you had to go be locked in the basement of the library for hours and hours and hours going through microfilm, you know, reading and trying to find, this is for the Black Periodical Fiction Project, trying to find 19th century Black women's serialized novels, you know, and looking at it when no one had looked at it for so very long was an extraordinary and beautiful invitation into this world of the life's work that we share. I cannot imagine a more beautiful life's work to be a part of. So, and to have a teacher who becomes your lifelong friend, let me not get emotional, is quite an amazing thing. The next person I met was Bob O'Mealy, because as you mentioned, you know, Skip was at Yale, Bob was a professor at Wesleyan. And if you know the geography between Middletown and New Haven, you might have to leave Middletown for a minute to come to New Haven to have a fulsome Black cultural experience. So I remember seeing you at the Afro-American Cultural Center. Maybe Danny's pictures were up there. I don't know, you know, but I think we were all in some of those same rooms at that time in the early 1980s when, among other things that were happening at the Afro-American Cultural Center, was August Wilson rehearsing his plays when there wasn't space at the drama school to rehearse those extraordinary plays that were in the making. After that, it was my beloved Farah, and I want to also mention Saidiya, because what was important about you ladies was that I went to graduate school at the University of Pennsylvania, Farah went to graduate school at Yale, Saidiya went to graduate school at Yale, and at that time, there were very, very few of us Black women, Black girls, who were studying Black literature and devoting ourselves to it, and you know, no interweb and no other way of finding each other, but knowing that you were there, that I was doing this crazy thing, going to graduate school, and I had just missed you in the same space, knowing that we were doing the same thing on the same track, and then we're at Haverford and Bryn Mawr on our dissertation fellowships, and thus began lifelong friendships, again, as caretakers, as, you know, to quote Du Bois, co-workers in the kingdom or the queendom of culture, that we were on that journey all the way along. Val, I heard of first from one of my graduate school friends, Nicole King. You had been her undergraduate mentor, and so again, like a Black woman professor teaching African American literature, that was a new one. And then as I came through and out of graduate school, you mentored me even though we had no institutional affiliation. You were not my teacher, but you became my teacher because, again, we were all on this mission together. And so now we're going back like 30 years, years and years and years. And then the baby, yes. But still, I think that we probably were first in a room together talking about Black poems that no one else had ever read, maybe 15, 20 years ago. I mean, you know, it's been more even. So it's been a very, very long time of this unlikely commitment to this culture that is what brings us here, making sure, and you know what I said today when I was teaching from the Norton to my class, I was talking about the inclusion of Maud Martha. And I was thinking, okay, I bet Val has something to say about that, because I remember never knowing that such a thing as a Maud Martha existed, that Gwendolyn Brooks had written a novel, and that in the same way that so many people handed their, you know, battered paperbacks of Their Eyes Were Watching God to each other before, you know, so like Their Eyes Were Watching God was not in print when I started, when I first read it. I mean, that is a hard thing to imagine now. But it was like literally, you know, hand to hand battered copies, and so too with Maud Martha. And Maud Martha really, were it not for your work and your advocacy, would not be available to us anywhere. I mean, that's one of, I'm quite certain that that's something that would have slipped through the cracks. So, you know, all of those details, I think, are really interesting ways to think about actually what is really at stake with you know, keeping this work alive. So I'm not an editor of the Norton. I am included as a poet in the Norton. And so I thought what would be interesting to do, also inverting the order of reading, is to talk a little bit about my own having been anthologized, about my own being anthologized as a poet, and talk about the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, and give a quick guided tour through thinking about where some of my work has appeared, to talk about a few things about why anthologies are so very, very important. And I wanted to do this also as a way of getting to the pinnacle of being anthologized, which was to be in the Norton Anthology of African American Literature. And to say that there, at least, if I am in this book, then the work as a poet that I have devoted my life to will at least have a proper context and a proper resting place. It will be where it ought to be. I would have perished if I was not included in this anthology. I did not lobby to be in this anthology, but one does covet, you know, being in certain spaces, but that this was the space that would be definitive, and was in that way, in a certain way, kind of, you know, culminating. So I thought that that might be kind of interesting. I was talking recently with the poet Kevin Young, with the poet, nonfiction writer, director of the Schomburg, anthologizer, you know, so all of his roles are very important, recently, about the 1980s and about how it was a relatively quiet decade for black poets being published. What you also need to understand in this whole anthologizing business, and Skip talked about, I remember those red bound, yes. You gave me a copy because I was, for a minute, I was going to write a dissertation on anthologies, yes. I was all, you know, and those red binding of all of those copies. So what you need to understand is that white anthologies, they were white anthologies. American anthologies were white anthologies. Mainstream anthologies were white anthologies. Someone here, someone there, every now and again the anomalous, you know, this one and that one. You know, when I began my publishing life in the mid-1980s, really American poetry anthologies were segregated spaces. For the most part. So that needs to be said. So that when I began to be included in anthologies, of course, also it is a bigger deal for a poet even than writing your own book, because again, it's someone saying you belong in a larger context. We want to make sure that this work is available and legible in different sorts of contexts. It's very exciting when your work gets chosen to be in an anthology. So I published my first book of poems in 1990, and the first anthology I was included in was a book called A New Geography of Poets. Edward Field, Gerald Lachlan, Charles Stettler, people I did not know before then or since, who chose my book to actually, it was an anthology that went state by state and chose American poets so there was no logical reason. I was a kid. I had written these poems. Why I was included, they liked the poems. They thought the poems were good. And so, you know, this in a way runs counter to what I just said about white anthology, you know, is that these white people put me in their anthology as a way of saying this is what's happening right now in American poetry. And what's interesting is that the poems, now I've got a project going, actually, because I took all the books out and I was kind of like, wow, it's been some books. A poem for Nelson Mandela and another poem called West Indian Primer. So a fascinating thing in thinking about being a black poet, a poet who writes about black culture and who writes about other things is what part of you is going to be anthologized. And I'll say more about that going through. I'm not going to talk about every single one. And then next was a book that meant a lot to me, In Search of Color Everywhere, a collection of African-American poetry that was my first black anthology. And that was brought out by Ethelbert Miller, who many of us know, who's a poet who at the time had founded and ran the African-American Resource Center at Howard University. This is where I grew up in Washington, D.C., Bobby O'Mealy, Brent Edwards. And so when I came home from college, I wasn't a poet for a while, but I was interested in writing and books and everything. So I thought, let me go on over to Howard. Let me just go to Howard. So I just went on over to Howard, hi Howard, I've come from Yale, I'm here. And so somehow, someone, took pity, in my, peasant skirts and my, hi, and said, you need to go talk to Ethelbert Miller. That's who you actually really need to go talk to about, beautiful black poems. So up I went, wah, 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 up to the stairs, and Ethelbert kept correspondence with writers and poets. And so he'd say, who are you interested in? And I'd say, this one, that one. And he'd go into his file cabinet and pull out letters and manuscripts and things that people had given him over time, and was very, very kind and very, very expansive. So what was special about being in this book, this was a coffee table anthology. So we're talking about a teaching anthology, and that book was a pretty book. It was meant to be a book that you put out and you thumb through. It was organized by subjects, not by periods, poems about family or poems about history or so forth and so on. And what made me especially proud was the title came from one of my poems, In Search of Color Everywhere. So that felt like, just the pinnacle of pinnacles. Then in 1994, and again, I'm not going to go through every year, I was included in the Harper Anthology of American Literature. So again, this kind of all of this canon moving and shifting was a way of also saying that mainstream anthologies had to start to catch up with black literature. Sometimes in the catching up, they get the ingenue and they skip over the people who should have been there in the first place. So that feeling of leapfrogging, if you will, into inclusion. I don't make any sense if I'm in an anthology that doesn't have, Gwendolyn Brooks, Michael Harper, Rita Dove, let's just say, right? So if they're just doing a sort of new generation thing, then, it seems like you're the important writer of your time, but really that's why, again, to the importantness of a really fulsome and deep historical survey, that's what you get in a Norton. Then, there are some anthologies, again, when you talk about pieces of yourself, and I'll just read a few little titles here. I Hear a Symphony, African-American Writers on Love. That wasn't a literary anthology. That was a kind of popular anthology. That was kind of cute. And then this book that was very important to me was called A Formal Feeling Comes, Poems in Conspicuous Form by Women, edited by Annie Finch, 1994. So in my first book of poems, I had one poetry teacher, Derek Walcott, and the way that Derek Walcott taught you to write was the way that he knew to write. He was a formalist, right? And at that time, I was very, very, poet nerd, maniacally fascinated with form. That was what I wanted to do. That was also what my teacher was instructing me to do. And also, I'm sure some part of me wanted to say, the thing that black people in culture have thought we might have to do, some have chosen not to do it forever, which is, I'm gonna write my way right on into your canon. I'm going to take this form, I'm gonna give it, spin it on its head, it's gonna come out of this, tradition that I also have that's mightier than your tradition, and so I will surpass you. You teach me language, and my profit on it is I know how to curse, So that was what it meant to try to master form. So this anthology was interesting because it was saying, there weren't very many women of color in it, but it was saying, what does it mean for women writers? And I think that Adrienne Rich is kind of the most interesting woman writer who's done that and then sort of broken open the form to make it her own. So that was sort of a fascinating one. Rebel Angels, 25 New Formalists, Mark Jarman, that was another one where it was like, okay, you know, I got up in their space with my black poems in that are sonnets, and, you know, like, that's done. Boomer Girls, poems by women from the baby boom generation, poems that are about places and communities that I was part of. Power Lines, the Guild Complex Anthology, that was a really amazing cultural center in Chicago that I was part of in years that I was there. Anthologies of the poetry society, if you will, for black poets, Cave Canem, that I helped found and build. Bright Pages, Yale Writers, 1701 to 2001. And again, what was, you can imagine, I don't need to put a fine point on it, you know, to say is like, I'm going to be in the Yale Writers Anthology that starts in 1701. You see, because that is actually, it's just the truth, but also it is saying something expansive about black presence. You know, so always an agenda with these things that you can't really shape that much, because one thing you can't do is beg your way into an anthology. You know, that just doesn't happen. Roll Call, a generational anthology of social and political black literature and art. Furious Flower, African-American poetry from the black arts movement to the present. Two little interesting subgenres. One is motion, American sports poems, and another one is yes, and another one is perfect in their art, poems on boxing from Homer to Ali. I closed that one out with my epic poem about Muhammad Ali. And then a number of poetry. Oh, one I love this because I want to say it: Nuovi Poeti Americani, which was an Einaudi book. So like that was my Italian translation. So I was very excited. Obviously, just the idea of that just was kind of fabulous. A couple of books I want to mention. Kevin Young's role as an anthologizer in the culture is something that we need to pay attention to. It's fascinating. So Kevin Young has put me in, I think, all of his anthologies. One of them is a little, one of those beautiful Everyman's Book of Jazz Poems, another beautiful Everyman's Book of Blues Poems, a poem of his called The Art of Losing, poems on loss, and another one which I really love, which I really recommend to you, called The Hungry Ear, poems about food and eating. It's a really, really beautiful book. And then also he did a very important generational anthology that's not just a poetry anthology, but it's called Giant Steps.
Yes.
And it's a fantastic anthology of kind of, you know, a new generation coming out of the 80s of African-American writers of all kinds. And, you know, he's a very good talent scout. So he's got, you know, early work by me, Danzy Senna, Colson Whitehead. It's a very, very interesting book. And one of the interesting things about that anthology, and one thing that's always interesting in anthologies, is who falls out. You know, who do you see someone and they're your favorite poems in the whole book, and then you never see them again. That is part of the poignancy and heartbreak that is in anthologies. There are many more, you know, words of protest, words of freedom, poets of the civil rights movement and era, you know, She Walks in Beauty, a woman's journey through poems. You know, I was very, very proud because I admire him so, and we've spoken about him, to be included in the Oxford Anthology of African American Poetry, which our revered and beloved Arnold Rampersad put together. But that, distinct from the Norton, again, is not a teaching book. That's surprising. I've never talked to Arnold about, you know, he arranged that book thematically, and it is a little bit of a, not a physically large coffee table book, but it's something that you would give as a Christmas gift. You know, it's thematically organized, and it's a brilliant, learned, beautiful anthology, but one that I'm surprised that he thought he wanted to do. Again, you know, that's kind of just a few highlights from many inclusions, but I thought that would be interesting to let us think a little bit about some of the questions about the parts of ourselves and the contexts that writers are included in anthologies. And so I will read two poems that are in the Norton. One of them, it's a poem. So also when people choose, so they chose, And so, you know, I always think, you know, thank you, and what about this one, and what about this one? You know, you want to be the most of yourself. It's not just about taking up space. It's about being, you know, if you sustain yourself as an artist, you are many different things over time. And so you always want, you know, kind of fulsomeness. But one poem they included is one that's been in a lot of books that did kind of open the door for a lot of other poems, and it's called The Venus Hottentot. And it's a poem that is about a Southern African woman. I'll tell you where this poem began, never told this story before, was, you know, and the relationship between reading and school and learning and making poems and art was reading Race, Writing, and Difference, the anthology that Professor Gates edited, and reading Sandra Gilman's article about this woman, Sarah Sarkey Bartman, who was brought from Southern Africa to Europe in the early 1820s. In the 1820s, to be exhibited nude in circuses and balls, and a scientist named George Cuvier dissected and examined her body and her genitalia and her buttocks by way of saying that he believed that the essence of African women was to be found in their genitalia, just as people erroneously believed at the time that the essence of European men was to be found by calibrating their brains. And so I read this very fascinating and disturbing scholarly article by Professor Gilman and thought to myself, but where is her voice? You know, where is her voice? And that was where, though I was in graduate school becoming a scholar at the time, I knew that scholarship would never make possible her voice, and that that was something that poetry could uniquely do. So I'm just going to read a little bit from her section. There's a first section that is Cuvier, the scientist, following the lead of Rita Dove in her poem Parsley, where she imagines, you know, the perversion in the mind of Trujillo before the massacre of the Haitians, that showed me that poetry could imagine that as well. So this is a little bit from her section. There is unexpected sun today in London, and the clouds that most days sift into this cage where I am working have dispersed. I am a black cutout against a captive blue sky, pivoting nude so the paying audience can view my naked buttocks. I am called Venus Hottentot. I left Cape Town with a promise of revenue, half the profits and my passage home, a boon. Master's brother proposed the trip, the magistrate granted me leave. I would return to my family a duchess with watered silk dresses and money to grow food, rouge and powders in glass pots, silver scissors, a lorgnette, voile and tulle instead of flax, cerulean blue instead of indigo. My brother would devour sugar-studded nonpareils, pale taffy, damask plums. That was years ago. London's circuses are florid and filthy, swarming with cabbage-smelling citizens who stare and query, is it muscle, bone, or fat? My neighbor to the left is the sapient pig, the only scholar of his race. He plays at cards, tells time and fortunes by scraping his hooves. Behind me is Prince Carmi, who arches like a rubber tree and stares back at the crowd from under the crook of his knee. A professional animal trainer shouts my cues. There are singing mice here. The ball of Duchess du Barry. In the engraving, I lurch toward the beldames, mad-eyed, and they swoon. Men in capes and pince-nez shield them. Tassels dance at my hips. In this newspaper lithograph, my buttocks are shown swollen and luminous as a planet. Monsieur Cuvier investigates between my legs, poking, prodding, sure of his hypothesis. I half expect him to pull silk scarves from inside me, paper poppies, then a rabbit. He complains at my scent and does not think I comprehend, but I speak English, I speak Dutch, I speak a little French as well, and languages Monsieur Cuvier will never know have names. Since my own genitals are public, I have made other parts private. In my silence, I possess mouth, larynx, brain in a single gesture. I rub my hair with lanolin and pose in profile like a painted Nubian archer, imagining gold leaf woven through my hair and diamonds. Observe the wordless odalisk. I have not forgotten my Hosa clicks. My flexible tongue and healthy mouth bewilder this man with his rotting teeth. If he were to let me rise up from this table, I'd spirit his knives and cut out his black heart. Seal it with science fluid inside a bell jar, place it on a low shelf in a white man's museum so the whole world could see. It was shriveled and hard, geometric, deformed, unnatural. And then, to conclude, and back to friends, of the selves that are made permanent in an anthology, some of that work takes place in the headnotes. And so that's a whole interesting conversation, too, about, you know, Professor Griffin started out saying, what, you know, I'm choosing from these even biographies, right? How do you decide what it is that you're going to put when there's a practical space limitation? And so one of the things that I was very happy that you all mentioned in the headnotes was the work that I did editing and bringing into publishing the late Melvin Dixon's book of poems, Love's Instruments, which I edited and brought out from Tia Chucha Press, a little of color poetry press, an amazing press in Chicago in the 1990s after he died from AIDS. That's work that I'm very proud of, and I think that this idea of you know, being responsible for the people in your community when they're not there to be responsible for their work is something that is continuous. And so of one of the other, the poem I'm going to end with, poems that you chose, was my poem, When. And that is a poem that was written when the AIDS crisis had really, in its first terrifying waves, started to move through our communities so profoundly, so mysteriously, so frighteningly. And some of the people who became ill and died were people who, and this is true for so many of us, people who had been cultural caretakers and mentors of mine, dance teachers of mine, people I danced with. And one of those people was Melvin Dixon, who I also met in some of those same rooms when he was a postdoctoral fellow at Yale University. He was the first person I knew who was a poet and a scholar, and also a novelist, and also elegant, and also a translator, and a very, very, very brilliant person. And he was the example, and he was very nice to me. I mean, I like tagged along, I tell you, like just, you know, everything was fabulous in his wake. And so I was like, can I go, can I go? And he was very, very kind to me. And among other things, was someone who I had many helpful conversations with about how do you write a dissertation when what you want to do is write poems. And how do you get through that? And I should tell you, you know, he had a method where he said, you know, you have a draft of a chapter, and then you put a piece of paper in between every page of your draft, and then you write in the spaces, and that's how you expand it. And he said, next thing you'll know, you'll have a dissertation. But that was really actually very wonderful for a sort of a second draft stage of things, to really have space before you to fill with your knowledge and ideas. So it was devastating when we lost him. And so what I felt was very important about your including this poem was that it was marking a kind of expansively queer space in the Black tradition, and I thought that was really beautiful. And also that it brought Melvin, you know, it further into the anthology, because surely were Melvin with us, he would have been one of the editors and would have probably been with us today. So this is a poem called When. In the early 1980s, the Black men were divine, spoke French, had read everything, made filet mignon with green peppercorn sauce, listened artfully to Boyfriend Troubles, operatically declaimed Boyfriend Troubles, had been to Bamako and Bahia, knew how to clear bad humors from a house, had been to Baldwin's villa in St. Paul, drank espresso with Shoyenka and Senghor, kissed hello on both cheeks, quoted Baraka's black art, fuck poems, and they are useful, tore up the disco dance floor, were gold lit, photographed well, did not smoke, said chow. Then all the men's faces were spotted. Thank you.
What a note. So we are not going to have a conversation amongst ourselves because we can do that at dinner. We're running late. We'll leave a few minutes for questions from you. But please join me in thanking this wonderful panel. So I wanted to open it up. If there are a couple of questions, now's your chance to ask. Any? Is that a question or just a standing up? No, not a question? Yes. Oh, microphone back here. Any? Oh, wait, here's the microphone coming. Yeah.
Thank you, everybody, for the night. This is wonderful. A lot of you spoke about differences of opinion, potential for debate during the process of creating this anthology. Sure. And I was very, very happy that Ms. Alexander, you ended on a note of friendship. That was what you began speaking about. I guess what I want to know is the anthology, when you have voices like Ellison and Wright, in conflict and conversation with each other, when you have to keep people from debating when you're doing this, was this project ultimately one of unity? Was it one of union, or was it one of difference? And is one or the other of those two things better than the other? Are they both to be celebrated?
You want me to? We had a choice between, it's the difference between a priori and a posteriori, right? Or it's one way to think of it, or inductively and deductively. No matter what we put between the covers, there was going to be an implicit logic to it that people would write dissertations about. And I realized that if we try to figure that out explicitly and agree on it among 11 people, we would never edit the anthology. Or if I was trying to tell Arnold Renner's that, I feel like I own the Harlem Renaissance just like Arnold does, right? And it's my period, and I have a thing about it. But I could not interfere with what Arnold Renner said was Arnold Renner, he was the prince, he was going to do it the way that he wanted to do it. And then when he retired, I was in a position to ask someone I admired. We had to get someone in the younger generation, just like when when Nellie passed on. It was logical for Val to be in the next generation. But I knew that Brent would internationalize it because he's multilingual. So he did the kind of, and he will in the next edition even more, internationalize the Renaissance in the way that I was taught the Harlem Renaissance between 1969 and 1973. So, you see what I mean? We didn't, our periods were in dialogue with each other, but we didn't slow down the editing process, which took a decade anyway, by having a dialogue about it. Sometimes someone would say, I think that Arnold should have put this in, and they would appeal to Nellie and to me. So then we'd have a conversation with Arnold. Or in the slave narrative period, edited by William Andrews and Fran Foster. Why wasn't this in there? Why wasn't that in there? But it could be offstage kind of quiet conversations, not big, whose canon is it? You're not doing this. I was curious that Brent Mary mentioned the permissions in space being one of the biggest surprises. That the whole thing is several grids within grids. You have 2,500 pages, it sounds like a lot. But a Norton is a course in the text. So you had to do so many whole texts. And we had to sacrifice cabinets, which is one of my favorite pieces of literature of all time, because copyright issues and we just couldn't make everything work. It sounds boring, but that's how you do an anthology. You only have so much money for permissions, you only have so much space. So we could not put all those things explicitly
on the table in advance of editing. The proof was going to be in the pudding, okay? So that was the only way that we could get through. In the end, we had a harmonious, fabulous anthology in dialogue, where the periods are in dialogue with each other, with relationships, formal relationships between texts, signifying, repeating, like leitmotifs, and it worked out. But the decision, and it was my decision, was a practical decision. I'm a pragmatist. I want to get things done. I don't want to spend the rest of my life. You know, Du Bois dreamed of editing the Encyclopedia Africana for 50 years. That would drive me totally out of my mind. You know, I wanted to move on, then do the second edition, then the third edition, then the fourth edition. Does that begin to answer your question?
Absolutely.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
And part of the answer, just briefly, too, is that between editions, we had stacks and stacks of reports from teachers and scholars recommending things that people were paid to read it and tell us what they thought should be added. And Skip was very good about, you know, letting us make decisions, suggesting without being insistent. But we had a lot of more than we needed advice from teachers, and some of it we took to heart directly. So there was input, and there was a kind of sense of democracy beyond what's been said already.
Yeah, Norton has this funny rule. You think that if you write a letter to a publisher, what difference does it make? Your letter is weighted like representing 10,000 people or 5,000 people. You know, if you get five letters saying Maud Martha should not be in the anthology or should be in the anthology, that's a big deal. And you have to consider that because it's a commercial company. It's not a charity, right? It's W.W. Norton. And they are trying their market teachers, the classroom. So you can canonize things by a strong critical essay brings a text from nowhere into the canon, and so does anthologizing, as I said earlier. And your letters to the us or to a publisher can bring a text into the canon as well. You have much more power than you think. You just have to exercise.
Yes, here and then back there.
I think Brent was going to say something.
Brent.
Well, I will say something if you want. I mean, unfortunately, it doesn't solve everything with those statistics and responses. 50% of the respondents wanted Nello Larsen's Quicksand. 50% of the respondents wanted Nello Larsen's Passing. You weren't putting them both in. You can read and think about, I think what Skip explained, they explained that each period editor had his or her own purview in terms of making choices, avoided some of that conflict in terms of the editorial work. My case is a little bit different, and there are a couple of other replacements that have happened. If you look at the headnote for Sterling Brown in the second edition and the way I revised it for the third edition,
thank God,
you will see the way, because I'm telling you this, I'm not sure you would have noticed this if I hadn't told you this, but you'll see that Arnold Rampersad and I don't agree about some aspects of Sterling Brown's career and his importance in the tradition. That's what I meant when I said it was very hard to write his voice in his wake. But I feel like on another level, what an anthology does is stage the internal difference of a tradition. So in my section, Alain Locke, Hubert Harrison, Marcus Garvey, and Paul Robeson do not agree. My job is not to take sides. My job is to stage that debate. That's what an anthology does, that kind of internal differentiation. So that actually, I think, was the task of anthology.
That's the simplicity and the polylocality you were talking about.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here, and thank you, Professor Griffin, for organizing this. I just wanted to know what you believe the place of the memoir is in the Black literary tradition. Memoirs are one of my favorite genres.
two of us have published best-selling memoirs.
Well, you know, here's a question. Is in the Black tradition, there are narratives, there are slave narratives, which in some ways, though those aren't the first things in the Black tradition, they're the first original genre in the Black tradition. So when do those first person narratives, what's the distinction between a first person narrative and a memoir? I don't know exactly what the answer to that is, except that I do know that as American history has moved forward and American cultural history has moved forward, one of the things that has been won is more space for an I that doesn't have to be instrumental, right? I mean, you know, the I of the slave narratives is trying to free enslaved people. You know, Frederick Douglass is, writing a book to set his people free. So I think that when you get to the time when Professor Gates and I wrote memoirs, those books can have many uses in the world, but I think there has been a free space created to say, who am I? And that even though, speaking about my own memoir, it is certainly a black story in a black tradition with many black cultural reference in it. But it is also a book that starts from the place of love and loss. I think that is hard won space in the cultural tradition.
Elizabeth is unusual in that she was already famous and wrote a memoir. We have the only tradition, this is not my insight, someone said it, I can't remember who, where people establish themselves as writers by writing memoirs or first-person autobiographies as their first book. And if you think about it, usually the person's famous and writes an autobiography. We become famous by writing an autobiography. This is not exclusively true, totally true, but it's true a hell of a lot of times if you think about the history of first-person memoir. And it's very curious. You know, I write, therefore I am, kind of thing.
That's great. Question back here, and then one more, and we'll close back there.
Would you all talk a little bit more about the decision to include Barack Obama in the anthology?
Sure.
Cheryl did.
Who included?
Well, it would have to be Cheryl. Cheryl Wall, you want me to get her on the phone?
But you know, that also segues on the memoir. We talked about that in class today, actually, about we were talking about Robert Steptoe's, you know, wonderful, wonderful book that we're lecturing.
From Behind the Veil.
Yeah, well, no, but
Blue is the Lake. That one? No.
No. No, the one about Obama's the lectures.
Uh-huh.
Come on now, all of our brains should be able to do that. But he
his
gave,
lectures at Harvard.
He gave, I know, that's why I'm gesturing to you. He gave a series of lectures at Harvard.
Right.
And one of the beautiful essays that he wrote was a very gorgeous, compelling read of, you know, scenes of instruction and in Barack Obama's dreams for my father, and you know, arguing for that as a book in the black tradition that bore relationship to slave narratives and bore relationship to Malcolm X and bore relationship to many other books in the tradition. And you know, again, we talked about how, you know, Professor Steptoe and I were colleagues at the time that he was writing it, and we just sort of marveled, like, the first black president is an actual black writer, like an actual black writer who read a book that you wouldn't just read for the information in it, but rather for the voice in it. Like, let's just think about that for a moment. But what I think is interesting that we talked about in class is there's not an excerpt from that, but there's an excerpt, it's one of his speeches that's included.
So it could have been permissions, space. Again, the decision would be very complicated. And also, to be honest, sometimes the publisher would say, Barack Obama's hot, he's the president. Can't you guys figure out how to put his voice in there? I don't think they literally did that, but they weren't above doing that. Then you have to decide how you would deal with it. But did you applaud a proof of inclusion of Obama or not? What did you say?
He said he asked for someone else.
Asked questions for someone else.
Oh, I don't think my colleague Cornell West approved of it.
There's a question up here, right up here. The interesting thing, though, is that he's probably one of the only presidents, maybe, well, not who could write, but who had read the tradition that's in the book.
That's the thing. He's right? The only president.
He clearly, I mean, maybe Clinton read some of it, but. But clearly he'd read, you know,
yeah,
when you read his writing, you can tell.
Read.
Deeply read it.
And
right.
Wrote out of that tradition.
Right.
Wrote out of that tradition.
And Steptoe's point.
Exactly.
And he's
exactly.
One of a few other speech writers as a form. Mm-hmm. I mean, Yeah, including a speech is quite an interesting gesture in itself.
Sure.
Well, in the whole oral tradition aspect of things too, so that's kind of actually a beautiful, that's neat.
The CD also contains speeches by King and Malcolm, mm-hmm. and all those kind of canonical speeches. Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm proud to say that so many of these people asking questions are my students in the second half of the African American Literature Survey. Yay. But that's okay. Just
trying to impress the teacher.
Not at all.
Is it on?
Yes.
Thank you, Professor, for organizing this event. I have a question about the role that, I guess, anthology as a genre plays in aiding discovery. And I, more importantly, for people who've been involved since the first edition, but also for those of you who've come in later, are there works that you've been able to unearth and have just been able to give them the limelight that they deserve and in the past 20 years have really started gaining traction? And how has that changed the academic landscape that you guys are a part of?
Robert O'Mealy has done more for Black vernacular culture in several forms by editing that the vernacular section and editing the CD than everybody else put together. I mean, really, in terms of the relationship of vernacular forms to the teaching of African American literature in the classroom, nobody has done more. I mean, indisputable. People never heard of Mahalia Jackson doing this. You know, that was teaching. Charles Davis, my mentor, never listened to that. So, Bob. Yeah, just take a bow, you know, whatever, I don't know.
Thanks for the compliment. But remember that you, right from the beginning, said if we don't have a signifying monkey sitting up in the book,
we ain't going to do the book.
We ain't going to do the book.
Shine in the Titanic.
Shine,
say, boy, may I make you rich as Shine could be? Money good, but money don't last. Shine going to save his own black ass. And Shine swam on. Now that is poetry.
Well, the question of how to represent a tradition where there are hundreds of versions of Shine, you're doing fine. You miss one stroke and your ass is mine.
Said the shark.
once you know they're all, which one are you going to choose, and which one will be the most resonant with the tradition as a whole without giving in to finding somebody who cleans it up so much that you don't get the
like Langston Hughes and Arnold Bontemps did in 1958. They can only include Shine and the Signifying Monkey if it was sanitized, so they're not fun.
So the shark said, you might be king. No. Shine says to the shark, Jason, you might be king of the ocean and you might drink the sea. You'd be a water splashing motherfucker before you out swim. you want that in the book.
Yes, you want it in the book.
You want that to be kind of bigger and poetry in there. And you want to be able to hear that so the students can pass it along. There were certain things we weren't allowed to do, by the way. We couldn't say fuck the police in the book.
No, you didn't say fuck the police.
Oh, interesting.
That was cut by the top of this thing. That's interesting.
Too. Yeah.
But,
footnote, we cannot print fuck the police.
Footnote, note they tried.
I was determined that the vernacular section would not just be my record collection. So I was surveying everybody that I knew, our editors, and anybody who really had a sense of which blues songs do you include. Mm-hmm. If you're going to pick the Negro spirituals there, you could scores, if not hundreds of them. Which ones are most significant for a literary tradition, for a cultural tradition as a whole? Then what version do you pick? You want to hear the Fisk Jubilee Singers if you can.
Mm-hmm.
And you need to hear a small church sing This Little Light of Mine, mm-hmm. along with, if you can do it, Leontine Price singing it in her exalted and crystalline way. So it was fascinating. It was a fascinating set of problems solved in collaboration with lots of people over a long period of time.
And if a text in one section had mentioned a sermon or a spiritual, then it made sense, all things being equal, to include that so that the parts were speaking to each other and it makes it more teachable. I've always wanted to edit the souls of black folk in a multimedia way, mm-hmm. with all the music, you know, and all the poetry being read, mm-hmm. and then Du Bois's voice. Du Bois had a fabulous voice. Sound like Victoria Whiteman, but so did Booker T. Washington. And to include their voices in the anthology is very important. I dream of finding Frederick Douglass. Mm-hmm. You know, he died in 1895, and there were recordings before. Mm-hmm. There you go.
That'll be a job for you all. So we're going to have to close it off. Join us for a reception. You can continue the conversation there. But once again, thank you so much for being here, and thank this wonderful panel.